voyage to Deep Space Nine, where an alien virus sabotages the station.
It's mutated into an airborne variety, which means the whole station is infected.
Who created this virus?
The Bajorans, sir.
Now, catastrophe threatens the outpost.
I can't allow you to break quarantine.
Better let her go, Sisko. She's all we've got.
And survival lies in Kira's hands.
This is kidnapping.
All I want is the antidote.
Next time on Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Depths of DS9, Episode 4, Babel. This would be sort of an early episode and also kind of a standalone, one of the first true standalones of the series, and also likely the first example of the phenomenon we referenced in the very first episode of the Depths of DS9, which is, in first season, there are a number of episodes that feel as if they were recycled somewhat from Star Trek The Next Generation. I am Razor Fist. Say hello, Terengel.
Hello, Terengel.
Now, saying that this was a recycled episode from TNG, which, by the way, looking into the episode a little bit more, it turns out Michael Piller had been talking about this apparently for 5 seasons before this on TNG. So this not only was a TNG episode, this was a TNG episode that had been kicked around for quite a while. It was written by the same guy who wrote the TNG episode Hollow Pursuits.
Good. I look forward to your report, Mr. Broccoli.
If you gotta have this as a filler episode, this is a pretty strong one.
Definitely.
And you're pushing forward a lot of stuff that you're gonna see as we go on. For example, one of the first things you notice, and it's something I've referenced on a number of occasions, it's Miles O'Brien as an engineer. Right off the bat, you're establishing he is not Geordi LaForge.
No, no.
He is not even B'Elanna Torres. He is a working man's roll up your sleeves.
And get in there.
Yeah, if I gotta use bubble gum and spit to fix the fucking replicators, we're gonna do it, right?
Right.
He is the working man's engineer, which I really dug.
Thanks for coming, Chief.
What are you doing out here?
That's probably the secondary phase modulator. We had trouble with them last week in the main power core. That should do it. Anything else I can do for you?
I also dug in the other big theme that you're going to notice in this episode is Odo and Quark. The interaction between Odo and Quark. Like, I love when Quark's replicators break down. I love Odo's just abject delight.
I don't get them fixed soon, they'll destroy my business.
Why not get O'Brien to fix them? He has the replicators on the command level working perfectly.
I'm on his waiting list. He assures me he'll get to them as soon as he can.
No telling when that will be. The Chief's a very busy man.
Apparently Armin Shimerman, the actor for Quark, this is one of his favorite episodes.
Really?
Of the series, because it was really the first time where he got to really inhabit the role of Quark, really kind of interact with a lot of people. Prior to this, he was just kind of a cliche, sneering kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I can see that. There was a lot more personality this time.
So basically, the plot of this is O'Brien is really behind on his repairs. He's really overworked, and he goes to repair one of the replicators that's malfunctioning, and in doing so, he triggers some kind of terrorist-engineered mechanism,
right,
that actually weaves a virus into the replicated food item that you have actually decided to generate. And basically, this virus turns you into a space autist.
It turns you into a blue checkmark.
Yes!
Let birds go further loose, maybe. Shout easy play.
Chief, you're not making any sense.
Round the turbulent quick.
What's wrong with him?
He appears to be suffering from a form of aphasia. It's a perceptual dysfunction in which aural and visual stimuli are incorrectly processed by the brain. His actual thinking hasn't been affected, but he's incapable of expressing himself or understanding others.
Victory strike limits frosted wake.
Like I said, this was sort of a recycled episode, but it does feel, because of those character interactions, you also get some Cisco and Jake Cisco stuff. Because of the developing relationships there, and also you get a little bit of Kira in there, it feels more DS9-ish. It doesn't feel 100% like a TNG episode. Interesting little bit of trivia. Worf calls Rom his assistant.
Yes.
Instead of his brother.
Fortunately, my assistant Rom was able to fix the replicators.
Yes.
I'm trying to remember into past episodes. Did he actually say Rom was his brother?
I don't think he did.
Before this point, because I'm struggling to remember. Rom was just someone who worked at the bar.
Yeah. Which is a classic example of how Armin Shimerman shaped the Ferengi in Star Trek. It's a shame the Ferengi weren't used much after this. But Armin Shimerman, like, really, he took them from a really one-note kind of a species and made them a proper race in the world of Star Trek, worthy of inhabiting that world. And part of that is the familial relationship between him and Rom. Although, you kind of hit this sweet spot with Rom, because early on, Rom is, like, sneering and kind of...
Yeah.
He's sort of villainous, and you'll see as we're going through DS9, many of you who are already following along and maybe have gone ahead, you've already seen, like, there's kind of a period at the beginning where Rom is just flat out, like, Snidely Whiplash with giant ears.
Right, right.
Then you hit that sweet spot in between where he's sort of a lovable doof.
Right.
And then, unfortunately, he goes from Rom to Rahm Emanuel.
You can't even dump industrial waste anymore because it might harm the natural habitat. I'm supposed to start worrying about animals now. Look how they live, wallowing in dirt, sleeping in trees. That's not natural.
I suppose you could argue that Ferenginar's biodiversity is a precious resource that belongs to everyone.
It's really cringy.
It's...
He starts instituting, like, socialistic reforms on Ferenginar. Oh, it's a full-body dry heave. It's awful. I also like that when they're investigating the device that's found, you initially think it's the Cardassians, and they swerve you on that one. This is classic Deep Space Nine right here.
Right,
because in TNG, this would have just been the Cardassians.
Yeah, they would have stuck with one bad guy.
But in DS9, you have to have that moral ambiguity, you have to have that gray morality, and so... Flip-flop, as they look into it deeper, turns out it was actually Bajorans.
Doctor, who created this virus?
The Bajorans, sir. I believe it must have been a terrorist plot to sabotage the Cardassians while they were here.
I said earlier while we were watching it, I don't understand if you were trying to engineer a virus and if the guy who engineered it was such a fucking genius, why didn't you engineer the virus to not affect Bajorans?
Well, you gotta get those collaborators, right?
Yeah.
And make sure you get everyone.
And it's an interesting sort of virus idea. This is kind of, again, you're getting into the space western stuff. I don't know if you ever watched Little House on the Prairie growing up.
Oh, God.
I grew up loving Little House on the Prairie.
Right.
And the best episodes of Little House on the Prairie were the ones with the doctor where they, like, that fucking town got every disease known to man.
I imagine so.
They're like, oh, we got Jimmy arm sickness this week. They got the anthrax one week. The town came down with anthrax.
How do you just come down with anthrax?
they
little what's-her-name was going, jumping through the field again, and oh my God, she got anthrax.
by the end of Little House on the Prairie, I swear to God, they were running out of diseases. They got typhoid one time.
Oh my God.
I mean, it was ridiculous. It was interesting because then the virus is sort of adaptable, right? So it goes through different modes. It starts out just being something that's communicable through replication. Then it goes airborne. And of course, then the only person left is Odo. He's like, fuck you, I'm Jello.
All job appalled.
What was that?
Red, the arrive, seen earlier.
Oh, I see.
I also dug, they set up sort of a triage, right? After,
right, right.
Which I don't get, because they don't really establish how immobilizing it is.
Yeah, that's why I was so surprised. Okay, I get they're speaking gibberish.
Yeah.
But I don't recall them ever saying something like, oh, it's also affecting blank and they're dying. It's like they just sort of started to die.
Yeah.
I don't get that.
Which is hard. They kind of wrote themselves into a corner there. Because you get the sense, like, if this had been written in ideal fashion, they would have had sort of a no-name red shirt die earlier to manufacture a sense of tension. But they kind of wrote themselves into a corner because the first guy to get it is O'Brien.
And right,
he's right. Got fucking plot armor, right? So you can't kill him off. So they had to have him move into grave condition for a little while, right? Like he got a space coma. And speaking of space comas, there was an excellent space Jew moment with Quark when they set up the triage.
Double, drinks, money, and mine. Give!
Well, Quark, I see even you couldn't weasel your way clear of this one.
You underestimate the Ferengi immune system, Commander. I'm merely here visiting my less fortunate customers to make sure they're not faking the illness to avoid paying their bill.
Don't you die before you pay me.
You gold owe me. Then we found out the virus is, of course, as we said, it's literally lethal.
Yeah.
Which, they didn't really establish that. And
they never said how.
And they never really showed anybody dying of it.
Right, right. They were carting one guy away, but yeah, it's never said if he's actually dead.
Yeah, if bad grammar is lethal, my comments section is fucked. And it's interesting because this is the first proper writing credit on the show from the showrunner, Ira Stephen Bear.
Right.
Which is probably why it's so good for a filler episode. It's actually got some very literate origins. I was already thinking this while I was watching it, but I actually looked it up. Apparently, this is based on the biblical Tower of Babel. I think it's in Genesis 11 or 12, where they talk about how God basically split all the languages of humanity into, you know, hundreds of thousands of variants, essentially. So you've kind of got a much more literate basis for the episode. There's deeper stuff going on underneath the hood. It's not just a bad pun, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
It's what we're saying here. Then we have the bearded Cosby sweater aliens.
Right, right.
Who could not die soon enough for me, by the way.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, what a bunch of annoying little pubes.
It's a rule. If you establish a quarantine in a movie or in an episode of a TV series, there's got to be the one asshole who wants to try to break quarantine and just leave.
Captain, cut your engines before you rip your ship apart.
He's not reducing power.
Jahil, I'm ordering you to stand down.
Your orders are no concern of mine. My entire crew has been confined to your hospital. I must leave now while I can still function.
And they get blown to shit, which is awesome.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, the captain survives, which is a shame. You're going to see this as a recurrent theme, actually, on DS9, where the station has a booby trap or something on it.
Yeah,
before the occupation. There's like two or three of these kind of episodes.
Yeah, I recall a few coming up, actually.
And pretty much, they're good episodes, too.
Yeah, yeah.
By and large, those are some of the better episodes. I vaguely remember that Empok Nor, that's a really good episode. A really good episode where O'Brien needs a part and they don't have it and he can't replicate it. It's too big. So they have to go to the sister station, the abandoned Cardassian station.
Right.
Empok Nor. Yeah, you're going to see this as a recurrent theme. There's a really good one where Gul Dukat has to come and save them because they trip an alarm system.
Right, that's the one that comes to mind.
I fucking love that episode.
Yeah,
it's fantastic. That's one of the real moments where Gul Dukat begins to shine.
There is no dilemma that cannot be solved by a disciplined Cardassian mind.
It's not going to work, you know.
What are you babbling on about now?
I'm talking about Major Kira.
What about her?
She's much too busy trying to save this station to be impressed with your incessant posturing.
Garrick!
But I think the real sort of selling point for this episode is not any of that. It's not really the world building. It's the relationships, as always with DS9. Quark and Odo are the real highlight here.
Absolutely.
They were merely contentious before, but like in this episode, they begin their long, amazing descent into an outright badass bromance.
Right, right.
And that's like the sweet spot for those two characters, where they hate each other, but they kind of need each other.
I'll beam you over.
You?
Relax. I served on a Ferengi freighter for 8 years.
Right.
I must have witnessed the procedure hundreds of times.
Witnessed? You mean to say you never handled the controls yourself?
Energizing!
There's a great episode called, I think it's The Ascent, where they are stranded on a planet and have to climb a
Right, I forgot
mountain.
About that one. I'm looking forward to seeing that again.
Yeah, that's a good episode, too, where they have to kind of band together and climb a mountain to put, like, a distress beacon or something on top of it, or else they'll
die. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Really good episode. This one is actually a very good episode, too, folks. So in wrapping all this up, it's kind of a filler episode, but man, if you gotta have a filler episode, it's solid. If this is sort of an Old West allegory, as we have often contended Deep Space Nine was originally intended to be, you know, TNG was supposed to be Wagon Train to the Stars, or rather the original Star Trek was supposed to be, this was the Rifleman.
Yes.
This was essentially, here you go, you've got a town in space. And if that's what this is, then this is the plague rolls into town and
right.
The doctor has to save the day. Only then Bashir gets infected. Pretty good writing here. Some pretty good performances, except from Dax. Sorry, she doesn't settle in for a while.
Yeah.
Takes a little while. She's still teething at this point. Babel, ladies and gentlemen. I have to say, it is recommended for a filler episode. You really can't go wrong on this one.
Highly recommended.
Definitely. We will return in the next episode, which should cover the fifth episode, Captive Pursuit, one of my favorites, also kind of a filler episode, but a bit of an O'Brien episode, and one that presages the Hirogen from Star Trek Voyager.
Ah.
For Terengel, I am Razorfist. Engage.
You go! Oh!